Now for our Health Report podcasters, we have our special add-on of questions.
That's right. If you want to ask us a question, as always, you can email us healthreport@abc.net.au like Josephine has. Josephine is writing in about some of the stories that we covered last week, Norman, about type 2 diabetes. She says, as someone with type 2 diabetes in medication-free remission through a very low carbohydrate diet, the other end of the spectrum, it was frustrating for Josephine that our most recent episode only talked about low-calorie diets and about drug treatment. Josephine's experience is that restricting carbohydrates instead of calories is just as effective at reversing diabetes and far more comfortable and sustainable. What does the evidence tell us about that, Norman?
Look, there is some evidence on low-carb diets. The problem is sustainability, and you know, a ketogenic diet is not necessarily sustainable in the long term, but it can reverse type 2 diabetes, but the quality of research is not brilliant. But it, you know, anecdotally, it does work.
The thing with diets does always seem to boil down to the best one is the one that you can actually do.
Yeah, and staying in ketosis is just tough, and your breath smells, and you've got to watch your weight as well. So losing weight is a good thing in type 2 diabetes. And in many ways, you get to the same point as you do with your weight loss diet. A ketogenic diet does lose weight.
Well, it seems to have worked for Josephine at least.
Yeah, so you've got to differentiate between, you've got to work out what's working here and what's not, and it may be that the weight loss is working too.
Greg has emailed in about grommets, which we spoke about a couple of weeks ago, Norman. Greg is 71 years old, has confirmed hearing loss. It's worse on one side than the other. He has that thing where if you close your mouth and nose and blow, you pop your ears like you do when you're on a plane. Remember going on planes? And he thought that it might be from a blocked eustachian tube. When he talked to his specialist about it, didn't get much of a response other than an offhand, "I could put grommets in if you like." What do we know about grommets in older people?
Well, eustachian tube dysfunction is a cause of lost hearing and can cause a problem in the middle ear because the eustachian tube basically provides air to the middle ear so it can function properly, and you can get a very contracted, stiff eardrum, which is not efficiently transmitting the sound to the inner ear. And there are various treatments. One is regular insufflation, which is what you're doing there when you blow your nose with one nostril. Well, you can either close one nostril and get a straw and bubble it into water. You can pinch your nose, swallow and blow at the same time. There's all sorts of things that you can do, but very hard to do that all the time. You can take
walking around with a straw and a glass of water. People look at you weirdly when you do that.
Yeah, it doesn't get you very far on the bar. And and then you can also take decongestants, but the problem with decongestants is that you can get a bounce back. The other thing that some surgeons offer is that you can actually catheterize the eustachian tube and expand it. And there are grommets, and I'm not sure what the result of grommets are in adults. And if you don't get a good response from your first specialist, get a referral to another who specializes perhaps more in the ear.
Good advice. Now, this question from Rodney really piqued my interest. I'm quite excited to hear your answer to this. Rodney writes that he's under the impression that connecting nerves of organs during transplant is generally not required and hence not done. But his question is about if someone with a heart transplant had a heart attack, would they feel it? Would they have the same symptoms as someone who hadn't had a transplanted heart? Or if you had a transplanted kidney, are you going to feel kidney stone pain, livers and lungs and other implanted organs? Tell us, doctor, what's the story here?
Well, kidneys and livers and lungs I don't know about, but the premise is correct. So in other words, when they transplant a heart, they don't reconnect the nerves that are attached to the heart. And the nerves actually do quite a lot of work. So they speed up the heart, they can slow it down. And what they rely on to control the speed of the transplanted heart is more the hormones that circulate in the blood and the natural ability of the heart to adapt. And so it's true that somebody with a heart transplant who's had a heart attack may not get the typical symptoms of a heart attack. They may not get pain. They can get pain, and there are case studies in the literature of people with a heart transplant who get the same chest pain as anybody else, and they're not quite sure why they get that. It's maybe that the nerves have grown back. They often get an abnormal feeling, an abnormal sense in the heart. They might get breathlessness. just odd feelings that they haven't had before. And if you had a heart transplant and you get new symptoms you haven't had before, you really do need to report back to your transplant unit or your cardiologist to see what's going on. And if you're really worried and it's really, you're getting breathlessness, you probably need to turn up at your local emergency department. I don't know whether you get phantom pains with a transplanted kidney. We might take that as homework for next week.
Yeah, but nerves do grow. They can repair and grow back. Do they grow into transplanted organs?
Yep, they can. And that's possibly what's happened.
So interesting. Okay, Norman, I've got a couple of COVID-related questions for you, but I'll just remind our audience that we have a podcast that answers your questions about the coronavirus. It's called CoronaCast. But Larissa's written in saying, she sees a lot of people saying they're not anti-vaxxer, but they just want the COVID vaccines to be proven safe and effective, and they want assurance that long-term studies show that there are no side effects, which is obviously difficult when we've only been living with the virus for a year and a half. And so she's wondering, based on previous vaccines like polio and measles and so on, what's the ideal sample size to deem those safe and effective? And what kind of long-term are we talking to give enough long-term evidence that something is safe?
Well, most drug research does not go on long enough to look for long-term side effects, including vaccine studies. In fact, the vaccines that have been approved for use have been approved at pretty much the same level of evidence that any vaccine's been approved. They might have gone on for a little bit longer to check on side effects, a few months more, maybe even a year longer, but not much longer than that. And so the sample sizes that you saw there with these vaccine trials, 30, 40,000, sometimes more than that, in different environments, Brazil, South Africa, Britain, America, etc., those are pretty much standard sized studies. And they went on a little bit longer than they probably needed to be absolutely sure. So they went on a couple of months. That was insisted on by the regulators to make sure there weren't any near-term side effects that would occur at round about a rate of 1 in 40,000. And then what's happened is, and again, it's unprecedented in medical history, is that as we speak, probably more than 3 billion vaccine doses have been given with unprecedented scrutiny. So we know now of side effects that we probably would never have found out about or not found out about for years, because there's been such intense observation of it. The Astra clotting problem is so rare that nobody might have noticed it in amongst the noise of other clots. And maybe 5 years from now, a hematologist might have said, look, I've seen this clotting problem and it seems to be related to Astra, and I've got it in two or three patients. Has anybody else seen that? And then a few hematologists pipe up. Same with the myocarditis, the inflammation problem with the Pfizer and Moderna vaccines. That might not have turned up for a few years anyway. So in a sense, you're seeing what used to be thought of as long-term side effects, but they're not necessarily long-term. They might be quite short-term side effects, but you only pick them up in the long-term because you're observing, because that's how long it takes. But we're in this intense period of observation. So the fact of the matter is that, in fact, there was an article last week in the New York Times by Eric Topol, who's been on the health report a couple of times, saying, pretty much, he was outraged that the Alzheimer drug that Sarah Sedgley reported on a couple of weeks ago, showing that it really doesn't have any effect, yet it's been approved for use at a huge cost, that got full approval, and yet Pfizer and Moderna have still not got full approval when the data for them is unbelievable, given the many millions of doses that have been given.
Right, and I think when you understand that, that reference framing, it actually can inspire a lot of confidence. And I saw one of the co-inventors of the rotavirus vaccine, Paul Offit, was quoted in some American media this week saying, in the history of vaccines, side effects have always appeared within 2 months of administration. There's never been a case where a couple of years down the track they pick up something that wasn't picked up initially, which I found really interesting, because that is one of the big sticking points, I think, for a lot of people.
Yep. I get a lot of reassurance from 3 billion doses, I have to tell you.
For sure. And one last question, another COVID-related question from David, who's asking about influenza numbers and what the numbers this year and last year tell us about the effectiveness of vaccines versus restricting international travel, and is wondering whether once COVID vaccines roll out more broadly, whether we're going to have to choose a trade-off between managing COVID like we manage the flu, where there are deaths and lots of cases each year, or not travelling internationally but keeping close to zero fatalities?
Good point, David. In 2019, we had about, during the flu season, we had about 300,000 cases. It was a bad season, mind you, 300,000 cases of influenza, lots of hospitalisations and quite a few deaths. This year to date, 358 to the end of June. So I think the third week in June, 358 for the whole year. And that's a combination of things. It's social distancing, it's wearing masks, and it's our international borders are shut. But essentially, flu flies in, and we haven't had people flying in with the flu. So there's lots of factors going on here. And on today's health report, Ryan McIntyre talks about needing to take, learning about this spread through airborne transmission, which happens to flu as well, and learning from that for the future. And maybe we go through some low flu seasons in the future.
I thought that comment about how we wouldn't accept dirty water, but we accept dirty air was really, that was a real light bulb moment for me.
Absolutely. And we just don't take it into account to the extent we should.